Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
God is good.
All the time.
God is good.
All the time.
God is good. All the time.
God is good.
And the reason why I stood out is I've been encouraged by this word. Amen.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but I thought this word was mine. Amen.
Amen.
I want to own it. And thank God I've managed to record it. To own it so I don't forget it all the time.
Amen.
If I happen to forget it, I go back to my mobile and play it again.
Amen.
Because it was a wonderful word.
Amen.
It was a beautiful word.
Amen.
And I want to thank the Lord for allowing our ears to hear such a word.
Amen.
Do you know that it's a blessing for your ears to hear these things at this time?
Amen.
There are a lot of people who are hungry for the word of God.
Amen.
But they are not hearing these things.
Amen.
These are meant for some peculiar people.
Amen.
For some chosen people.
Amen.
So when you hear such word, you need to treasure the word.
Amen.
And grasp it.
Mm.
And take it.
Yes.
And hold it.
Yes.
And keep it.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I say to myself, where do I start by changing this mindset?
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Where am I going to start changing this place? Because if I don't, I am like the people who missed to see Jesus.
Amen.
We were not different from those people, by the way. I can easily miss him because of
my
and what do I do and these things? What do I do to help myself not to be in that situation? You know, in life you always grow up and wish the best for your children. If you happen to make a mistake, you always tell your children to do better than you. Hallelujah. Is that not what we say, tell your children?
Yes, amen.
If I was a carpenter, I want my son to be possibly a manufacturer. Go higher than where I've ended. And here's the situation, brothers and sisters, where the old church missed to see Jesus. They missed with the same eyes we have. And with this mindset, which is almost the same with ours. It's not different. The span of years, 2,000 years ago, doesn't make any difference. We've got technology in our day, which can even make our situation worse. They miss to read the weather sometimes with this technology. So it's not going to help us. We need a spirit which can reveal the truth.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We need a spirit which can... Do you know when Brother Jonathan was talking, I said to myself, that's why Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
Amen.
Because these things are truth. These things are real life words. If you understand, or if you understood what has been mentioned, you realize that's where the life is. When Jesus was talking to the disciples, when they said, when he uttered this statement that increased our faith, the disciples had been told something which they could not comprehend. And that's why they said, oh Lord, increase our faith. The faith is increased by truth. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jesus went on to then explain and give them more truth, more details. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And this is what he did here when he met these two guys walking with their old mindset that Jesus would probably not come. This was the wrong Jesus. I guess this is what they were saying. This is a wrong Jesus. They were expecting maybe another Jesus.
Right.
That if this Jesus failed us, then let's hope for another one. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That configuration of the mind required himself to appear. Mm. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That rotten mindset which could not understand. And by the way, I'm so excited that when Brother Jonathan was talking about this, in Sunday, last Sunday, our brother stood up and he spoke about the two guys going walking into a mouse. And they were blinded by their knowledge and their mindset. Exactly, that's the way he was talking about. I'm going to feel my turn. Same message. Hallelujah. And I come here, I hear a lot of it. And I said, my God, what can we do? Hallelujah. And Jesus decided to reveal himself to these people. There must have been a reason why. Because he realized that if he had not revealed himself to these people, otherwise they would have gone on and maybe told others that forget about the third day. That there's nothing going to happen in this third day. It's gone and it's gone. So he needed to cut short that mentality. And I see it in the Samaritan woman. Hallelujah.
Amen.
When Jesus met this woman, this long conversation where Jesus ended up saying, if only you knew the person you are talking to, that he can give you water which can quench your thirst. If you only you knew, that was a mindset which didn't know, and that's where we are sometimes, we don't know him. And this woman knew that the Messiah was going to come. She knew, she was expecting that the Messiah would come one day. The scripture said that. If you go further with that scripture, it says, when they were talking, the woman said, we were told that the Messiah was going to come. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That means she knew that the Messiah was going to come. And this is, I think there are two occasions when Jesus revealed himself to people. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And that woman was so privileged to hear Jesus saying, I am the one you are talking about. Brothers and sisters, there is need for a revelation in our minds. I work in an environment where people say they hear voices, they talk to themselves, and all sorts of things. But I think as Christians also, I think we are confused of what we hear. I say to myself, if our expectation is to see a Jesus who probably with our generation, a Jesus who is a bit modern. Because the one who came was not modern. I sometimes have those expectations because when he rose, I think there was fanfare, there was some glory. When he rose again, he was able to go in each and every place without people knowing, seeing him. So there was some supernatural in him. I have that mindset. But I can be lost and miss him in that expectation of seeing a supernatural God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And what Brother Jonathan was trying to show us is we probably believe in our own cocoon, which is not what God is expecting us to be in that environment.
Amen.
And forgive me, I think when we're out, we spoke briefly with his brother that a lot of people nowadays, when we go to churches, we're expecting our own sort of ways to be done in church. We're expecting certain things to follow certain protocols. That means it's becoming our own church, not the one which we are talking about here, where the master builder is the one building. And I'm worried that we're not different to the people 2,000 years ago, the way they were thinking, the way they were expecting things. We're not different to them, brothers. If we're different, someone needs to tell me in my blood, I can feel that we're not. We can miss this guy. If he's to come, we can miss, and I think we miss him in a lot of situations, because Pastor was talking about people expecting to go in a church where the pastor drives a Range Rover. The likes of Paul, they didn't drive Range Rovers when they were preaching to people. They go in a church where they expect the pastor to be wearing a suit of a certain amount. And we can miss that, because that's what you think is. And if you're watching television, I think you'll probably be seeing the same kind of things in a lot of churches which are being screened on our television. And you'll be thinking, that's where God is going to come from. Hallelujah. And yet, from what has been explained here, very few people knew about his death. And probably very few people knew about his death as well. And very few people knew about his resurrection.
Yes.
I said, my God, I don't want to be in that mentality. How can I change? How can this mentality be changed to accept that God can just come to us in any form? And there's a church, and I believe it. There's a church, there's a new church coming. Because mind you, these churches we now have, I think they are following the same pattern. They are following the same kind of plan. It's totally different to the church which the Lord is asking.
Hallelujah.
I think we need to go back and pray and reference the word of God. When Jesus comes to people, the first thing is gives them the word and the truth. There's an atmosphere where sometimes we live in just knowing this as history, but there's truth in this thing. There's truth in these things. I like what the chapter which Brother Jonathan touched about Paul saying to Timothy that can you go to that scripture just briefly? I'm not going to stay long. I think it's 2 Timothy 2, verse 4. There are three important sentences which I just want to elaborate.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. 2 Timothy 4, verse 7. Brother Jonathan talked about it.
I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
I fought a good fight.
Hallelujah.
How do you fight a good fight? How do you fight a good fight? Yes, a father telling his children that my time has come. But let me tell you what. I fight a good fight. Fighting a good fight.
Amen.
I think it goes in line with what you're saying, that sometimes you go through difficult situations and you're happy. You're happy in there, you praise the Lord in it.
Yes.
You're fighting a good fight and you're saying, I am fighting a good fight.
Amen.
How is it good to you?
Amen.
This needs some changing.
Yes.
I fail to understand that. How can a fight be a good fight? So it means, if Paul was saying this at the last minute, he's saying, I fought a good fight. It means, in his life, there was what you call when people fight in wrestling, there was that wrestling thing. That means Paul was always in that ring, that's the word. Paul did not come out of the ring. All his life, he was in a ring. Because if he can say when he's about to die, I fought a good fight, that means he was in there. He was always there. He was fighting in there, he didn't come out. The second sentence, what does it say?
Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness.
I finished my course.
I finished my race. Isn't it? I finished my race. It means Paul was always racing. All his life he was racing with people. The definition of racing is you are racing for a competition with some other people. You don't race on your own. There's got to be 10. Coming to rest with you.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
He's saying, I finished my racing. It means the person who finished the race is one. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That thing felt the only says, I'm waiting for my crown. What does the last one say?
I've kept the faith.
Oh, Jesus Christ. He said, I've kept the faith. That's the last thing he says. If it was my father saying to me, you know, my son, I fought a good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. I will think twice. And I'll probably ask him, how did you keep the faith? Because you don't keep something which you don't have.
Yes.
You're keeping something which you have and which you guard all the time.
All right.
Paul is saying, I have kept the faith.
Amen.
So in the fighting, in the running, there was a keeping of the faith.
Mm.
So in other words, faith was helping to fight.
Mm.
Faith was helping to run.
Uh-huh.
And he kept it.
Yes.
And that's the thing which the Bible says in Romans and Hebrews, if you don't have faith, it is impossible to please God. And that's the one he's saying, I've kept it. I kept it, brothers and sisters. I kept it in my journey. I kept it in my running. I kept it in my growth. I kept that faith. We need to understand. You see, if the word is being preached, we need to seek the truth.
Amen.
The Spirit of the Lord to help us.
Amen.
May this word find some space in your heart.
Amen.
Because if you don't have a space for this word, you don't know what will be in your heart. May God bless you.
Amen.